peoples, what's up? Welcome to Shelf Stories, the channel that tells tales from games, books, and life. I am your host, Jason. Thank you so much for stopping by for this latest history chat episode where I break down the historical background of a game that I have been playing. The game that I'm going to be presenting today is Freedom, the Underground Railroad. And we'll tell you all about why I picked this game, why it's important in just a second. But I would like to introduce a gentleman who is going to assist me. And by assist, I mean teach me a lot. He is a doctor, a scholar of African-American history. He's at Bowdoin College. He's also a gamer. He runs the Ludica blog over on BGG, and he is very available. He has a very active Facebook. You'll learn a lot just by perusing the social medias of Mr. Dr. Patrick Rael. Welcome to the show, Patrick.
Thanks so much for having me, Jason.
All right. So before we get into Freedom, the Underground Railroad, I just wanted to give you a more proper introduction. If you are a longtime listener of Every Night is Game Night, the podcast that preceded Shelf Stories, You've been a guest on the show before, and we have talked about this very game.
That's right. But so much has happened in the last few years. It's a great time to talk about it again.
We talked about it in 2017, and now we're here at 2021 in February, Black History Month. So one of the tie-ins that I've wanted to look at in terms of looking at freedom again, it is the gift that keeps on giving in many ways. So, but before we get into freedom, please introduce yourself to the audience. Maybe they've never seen your face before. Maybe they've read your blog, but they haven't seen your face. Introduce us and talk to us about how you marry your academic interest with your gaming interest.
Yeah, thanks. So I've been at Bowdoin for about 25 years now. I got my PhD in African-American history at University of California, Berkeley, back in the 90s. And one of the things that I'm really interested in doing is trying to figure out if we can think about historically themed board games as a representation of history, not dissimilar from maybe Hollywood feature films. So so much history is taught in this country through popular culture. It has always seemed important to me to help students sort of sift through that and think critically about what we're seeing. Mm-hmm. That's particularly important these days when there's so much going on in African-American lives, and there are such deep historical roots, and those roots are being invoked in popular culture all the time. So okay. It's important, I think, that we be able to critique the way that happens.
Mm-hmm. You can go ahead and check out his blog, Ludica, on BGG. He has broken down Freedom of the Underground Railroad. He's broken down Secret Hitler. Had took a stab at some Mr. Phil Eklund and his games. We're not going to touch on that controversy now, but there is a very interesting breakdowns of all the historical background of all these things if you go ahead and check out the blog.
Thank you.
So maybe we'll have you back on to talk about some of that other stuff at some point.
My pleasure.
All right, but today we are here to talk about Freedom, the Underground Railroad. So I did a full Dice Tower review. It launched on February 1st, the first of the month, Black History Month. And so I'm going to refer you to that. So go ahead and press pause and go ahead and check out that review to check out all the gameplay, the overview, and my issues and the things that I like about as a game. We are here to talk about the historical background and the issues surrounding Freedom, the Underground Railroad, which was released in 2012. And it's interesting that we're looking at this game again because it's been 2012 and no other game has come out like it.
It's true. Well, I would imagine that somebody would have picked up on that theme. I think Brian Mayer, the designer of that game, laid down a marker that has yet to be picked up.
Maybe we can kind of like theorize, but I getting into people's heads, I don't know if it's that it's a case where they just don't want to, or it's like, you know, hot potato, the original publishers got into a little bit of controversy. We'll get into some of those right now. And maybe publishers don't want to enter into that space. Please, publishers, enter into that space. Not just like, you know, the Underground Railroad situation, but just any game that centers oppressed peoples and their struggle for whatever it is, liberation or economic justice or something. You know, we need more games from that particular perspective. I think Dr. Rael and I are on the same page in terms of wanting more of that in our board games.
It's true. We tend to get games that where slavery is historically represented in some way, but usually it's something you can practice or not practice. So if you look at games that are about exploration and expansion, Struggle of Empires, Endeavor, Archipelago, Archipelago doesn't have slavery, but the others do. There's a couple others in that vein. And usually slavery is presented as something that you can practice. It is right. A gameable option, but you're doing it from that perspective. Freedom was so interesting because it didn't challenge players to undertake that moral, question of whether I want to play slavery or not. It was all about asking players to help destroy slavery. Mm-hmm.
More, please.
So. Well, it's fascinating the way it does it. And one of the things that I'm always trying to focus on with my students as we think about games as a form of historical representation is not just what the game says it's about, right? So we know that Freedom is a game that's about the Underground Railroad because there's this beautiful picture on the front and it tells you, and the rule book tells you, all these things that are not the actual game itself tell you about what that game is supposed to be about. There we go.
There it is. This game can't be about anything else.
Exactly. We know what this game, at least what it says it's about. Then you get into actually playing the game and thinking about how, what is unique to the form of game here that conveys that message? And so how do the mechanics convey the message, right? Right. That's sort of Brenda Romero's riff on Marshall McLuhan's famous line. So
the mechanism is the message.
Yeah, the mechanic is the message, right? In the same way that the medium was the message. In Freedom, the mechanics marry with the theme very well, in my opinion. So you get, it's a cooperative game. You're working together, right? There's not, there's a powerful implicit statement there that speaks to the necessity of working together collectively for social action to make things happen. So to me, that's just right off the bat, you get this really beautiful marriage of what the game is trying to represent, working together in a social movement with the actual gameplay elements themselves.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so before we get into the actual gameplay elements, as Dr. Rael was talking about, let's get into some of the meta issues that people have discussed about this game. And there are some significant ones. And we'll start with, to me, kind of the easiest one to address, but it definitely needs to be said. This game was made in 2012 by Marizo as a white person. And the publisher, the Academy Games, is a white publisher. So I think right off of Jump Street, if you're looking at the BGG page, you're looking at the names associated with this release, you're seeing white people. Okay, this is a game about slavery. It's a game about that depicts suffering. It depicts in a certain way, but at the same time, slavery was a suffering reality. And now we have a bunch of white people that are profiting off of this game. So how would you address just that particular criticism off of Jump Street?
Yeah, it's a viable one, I imagine, though I don't know enough about the designers of the game and the publishers to be able to speak to it, very cogently. But Academy Games generally produces what they present as educational games. And this game is very much presented in that vein. Okay. It was designed by, I believe Mayer is a library professional. Mm-hmm. And it comes with it doesn't come with, but you can buy with it basically a teaching unit. It's all about how to use the game in class. So there's very clearly the intent or effort is to educate, which seems like pretty fair game to me. It sure. does not look like somebody was trying to kind of get rich off this game by exploiting somebody else's trauma, but that's always a possibility. And it's one that we've seen trivialized in other parts of the hobby. Scramble for Africa, for instance.
Right. If you don't know what Scramble for Africa is, you won't even be able to Google it. It's been thoroughly erased from the record, probably deservedly so.
Yeah, but I mean, it raises important questions about the designer's intent in producing a game like this. When Martin Wallace designed Struggle of Empires, which is a game that includes slavery, I don't think that was his first idea. He wasn't thinking about you know, I'm going to first start with slavery. I think for him, slavery, and in that game, it's almost sort of incidental, right? These are, in games like this, slavery, you don't have to play it. You don't have to be confronted by it, but it is an option there. In freedom, the perspective is entirely different. Their motivation for writing the game is entirely different. It was purposefully to speak to those other games that challenge players to actually engage in this morally reprehensible activity. And it relieves them of that and lets them encounter this history without having that kind of burden, that weight.
Right. To me, it feels like you can go one of two directions with that criticism. You can say no one. You know, no one should make a game like this. No one should profit off of a depiction like this. Or you can say we need more diverse voices making diverse games. So give an African-American designer, a Latino designer, if we're going to talk about, you know, the Mexican invasions, you know, just from the American experience, to talk about, you know, a Chinese designer, if they want to talk about Asians coming over and you know, basically constructing America's railroads. Yeah. Do we want less or more? And I think, you know, and obviously that may be an unfair characterization of it, because who doesn't want more? I think that I want to definitely honor people who they sense too much trauma in the experience. Like, I know a lot of people who won't play Freedom, and I'm perfectly like, yes, please, dude, if this is bringing stuff up for you, please, you know, avoid that. And the community it should be upon us to help people, you know, not engage in that stuff. You know, don't you like pop the, oh, you're an African-American, you'll want to play this. That's definitely not the way to go.
Right.
But do we need to shut it down entirely? Is there no justification whatsoever? And I think what you're speaking to is the educational value of it, and the realizing of that, you know, people are different. They learn differently. We learn by engaging in popular medium. They're not going to stop. You know, Marlowe is not going to stop printing all these different games. So as an accommodation, you know, I think that where we're at is like, okay, we want more from more diverse.
You hear so much of the discourse around games because it gets wrapped up into this stuff. Well, this is the only way to depict it. And that's complete nonsense, right? I mean, it's like in a similar way, like the reality, take Westerns, when African-Americans started being in Western themed movies, like Will Smith or something, you know, there was literal criticism like, oh, there weren't that many African-Americans in the West. And it's like, that's not even true.
Yeah, so first,
you know, the whole,
right.
the set of like ideas that we come to these games with absolutely has to be exploded. And you know why that is, partly because this is a hobby that for so long was kind of the domain and the production mechanisms were so long the domain of white people who just weren't particularly, you know, weren't explicitly interested in that experience. So in the same way that diverse voices have changed professional history, professional literature, all fields of scholarship have been transformed by the addition of diverse voices, that's got to happen with games as well. Right. And there are efforts, thankfully, now. I mean, I think about the Zenobia Award. Are you familiar with that? That Volko Runka and some others are putting out, you know, really trying to prime the pump and to get some designers of color working so that the industry can recognize folks. Mm-hmm. Very, very similar way. Progressive voices in history are calling for diverse scholars to be footnoted and cited, you know, that we're going to make an effort here to ensure that everybody is included.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So then it kind of raises another question, and this came up. I've done a couple threads about this, and there was a very good response that one of the points in the response was that, because I think you're coming at it from your professor. So of course, education is primary, right? I think if I'm stating the thread correctly, it's that, okay, I get the idea that you want to teach history through games, but the thing is, it's a game. And there's something reductive about engaging in a game. There's something that, you know, we're trivializing, and like a board game will never be able to truly honor what encompass the reality of what it is. Just by the medium itself, it is reducing, it is simplifying, it might even be, you know, whitewashing or whatever you want to word. Like, it doesn't translate. So whatever lessons are learned off of the game are going to be just the wrong lessons. that, like, you know, you'll never learn, you know, how bad something is. You'll never learn how, because it's a game and games are supposed to be fun. So how would you respond to the idea that games kind of, you can't learn good history off of a game?
Right, right. That's a beautiful question. We used to think the same thing about Hollywood feature films, right? So you show Glory, the high school teacher would show Glory in June at the end of the semester or whatever, just get it done. But the historical analysis of Hollywood feature films that are historically themed is very deep and very rich. It has become so. I promise the same thing is going to happen with board games if we continue in this vein. It's already happened with video games where, you know, new media studies scholars every year produce dozens, if not hundreds, of essays on the representation of history in Assassin's Creed and other kinds of games like that. Mm-hmm. So the kind of analytical apparatus is being built right now that will help us contend with board games and the particular way that they do their work. What you said of, or, you know, the kind of potential criticism, which is that they're trivial and reductive. Well, the triviality is a matter of perspective and game, right? You can, if you're betting the mortgage at Vegas, you're playing a game that is not trivial at all. Or if you are dealing, you know, there are CIA war, you know, there are war games used by the government. I mean, so it's possible games are not inherently trivial, even though they are inherently playful. So
interesting distinction. You said that games are playful, but not trivial. It's a very interesting distinction.
Yeah. I think play is serious, which gets us into a more philosophical kind of conversation.
Absolutely. Yeah.
But the other piece of what you're saying is that, like, that somehow the medium itself could not capture the past in its complexity. And one possible counter to that is to suggest that no medium can do that. That if we're talking about historical feature films or historical fiction, we're going to have similar challenges of reductivism and selection. Even scholarly monographs and the big history books that sell a lot are still engaging in processes that game designers have to think about to some degree. Mm-hmm. What parts of the story are important? What is the perspective I'm going to take? What is the evidence or the stuff of history that I'm going to bring in? How am I going to reference the past in specific ways? Am I going to do that responsibly? What is the point I want to make when I do all that? Mm-hmm. Those are common in whatever kind of historical work you're doing, I would contend.
I'm looking down because I'm taking notes, people. So if you're not breathing in the knowledge, I told you I was going to be learning from this man.
It's so fun. And it's so exciting to be around board games when this stuff is happening.
Sure.
And I think that you're right that we're way, way behind in having diverse designers working on this stuff and having publishers understand that. But I think that is rapidly changing. And I think that we're seeing possibilities for thinking about some of these difficult histories that are where all the designers are kind of teaching each other and riffing on each other. And as those voices grow, it's going to be more and more interesting.
Mm-hmm. All right. I mean, basically, games are not just games. I think we almost need another word, you know, because I feel like if we're calling something a game, we're already kind of baking in presuppositions by what we'd name it. And I'm a psychotherapist. Change your mind, you can change the world. Like, you literally, the way you code things with your words lead you down certain places. And I think calling them games is allowing us to refer to these pieces of art, these pieces of culture, these things that exist downstream of culture. We think of them as trivial. We think of it as non-serious. And yes, much of gaming is a trivial pursuit. These are clearly games that, you know, and it's very easy to just, you know, do violence. You know, and I have my criticisms of colonial games, and I've articulated them. But a game like Freedom feels like it's doing something so radically different that I don't want to associate these two things.
Yeah.
And I just want to finish the thought and I'll get to that. I think that there are a lot of people, because I want to honor people's perspective. I think that they don't want to separate. Like, it's all a no-go. And I want to definitely honor that. I just wanted to articulate my perspective. I think I'm on the same page as Dr. Rael. I don't want to lower games down. I want to lift them up.
Yeah. Yeah, I think, and people encounter these issues in such a broad range of ways. Everyone is highly individual and personal. And I think that we have to respect that. I think a one size fits all is simply not, it's impossible anyway. So, you know, why even try for that? But I think that games, when they work right, let us explore options in a, the thing about the triviality of games is that we get to play, we get to do things imaginarily that we might not otherwise be able to do. Right. And that doesn't mean we should do anything that we can imagine. That doesn't mean that any imaginative play, all that there are no boundaries at all, but it means that we can explore things in ways that are might feel to some of us a little bit safer than others. So it is hard to encounter the stories of from the Underground Railroad. It is not easy to read through that material, to read through 12 Years a Slave, for example. It's brutal. To play the game may be, for some, a way of encountering that material that draws them in, that gives them the invitation to work with what they might not otherwise work with. And that is really important. Any critical engagement with the past, in my mind, is a good thing.
Done well. Done well. There are rules about this stuff, and I think that we can discuss those rules. We can. But I just, in terms of honoring people's perspective and drawing kind of the fault lines of the discussion, I think is pretty valuable work in and of itself. Yeah. So one last issue, and this is a little bit wonky, so I apologize to the audience for getting into a wonky issue, but it comes up sometimes. The terminology, slave versus enslaved person. Yeah. So the rule book says slave. And I think that we're used to that from the way we've spoken. And there is, like in a lot of areas, you know, a reevaluation. Okay, how can we, you know, be more careful with our words? And I think that some folks are going to want to say, okay, let's say enslaved person instead. I'm not sure what the academic, because I'm not in academics, you are. I don't know what the current kind of thinking is about that particular turn of nomenclature.
Yeah, that, I mean, I think the notion behind speaking of enslaved people is to acknowledge that personhood, right? That sort of social death, to use Orlando Patterson's famous phrase, that goes with slavery. You're trying to negate that, to push back against that. These are people with agency. These are people. They're not just objects who were acted upon. Now, that kind of scholarship has been done for a long time, since the civil rights movement, the 60s and 70s. But I think this the suggested change in the way that we reference enslaved people is about speaking to that, is about continually making sure that we are not abstracting people out of existence in some way. Mm-hmm.
But does that mean that the old term should be shunted away? Does that mean that we should because I think that's where it goes, where it's like, you know, don't use that term anymore, use this term. I don't know how you feel about that particular kind of thrust of it.
Yeah, I think that I have witnessed an awful lot, a very wide range of opinion on this. People come at this from different angles. I tend to think that hypervigilance on these things isn't particularly effective, you know, beyond a certain point that, and there is a, so, I mean, in my use, when I'm writing, I refer to enslaved people. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I'll use slave as an adjective. But there's a little bit of flexibility there. So I just tend to find that if we set rules, I often find myself breaking them inadvertently. So I would rather keep the notion in mind rather than have it be a 100% dictator. Okay. But, you know, every instructor is different, every family is different, every person is different. Mm-hmm.
And so I think I can only see that the people that are like watching going, well, what's he going to say about it? Again, I don't have any answers. I just want to frame debate, and I'd love to continue the conversation in a way. Like, I really want to, I know I'm a broken record with this stuff, but like, I really am serious. Like, if the best that I can do is frame a debate and represent both sides well, then, you know, I'm happy to do that and carry the conversation forward from there.
Well, these are usually very value-driven kinds of conversations anyway. So it's the having of the conversation, I think, that is so vital very often.
All right. So let's get to the game itself. Freedom of the Underground Railroad, published in 2012. Once again, why are we going? Give us more. No, but I'm happy to go back there because it does have a lot to say. And so one of the things that I've been developing is if you are going to depict slaves in your game, so like rule of thumb for designers, and I thought through this with Sen Phun Lim and a couple other people in a video chat, and I've been having a lot of conversations, and I've come to like, you know, this is kind of a three-pointed star, right? If you're going to have slavery in your game, you need three things. You need the slaves themselves accurately and like as much, you know, respectfully presented as possible. You need their resistance and struggle for liberation or something, whatever they're achieving. And then you need the oppressive, the repressive stuff. That is, you can't get slavery without these three things, right? And I think games try to get away with the one thing, or maybe, you know, the second thing, but they don't include the whole picture, which is basically true of all of history. You never get slavery without aspirations for a liberation. You'll never get slavery without brutal repression. It was never a fait accompli. So I want to talk about freedom in those three areas because it has all three things, right? So let's talk about the first thing. Let's talk about how the slaves themselves are depicted. They are wooden cubes, unpainted. They come on, they're on cards, then they move on to the little plantation spaces, then those are the things that you are moving on the board. That was a specific choice by the designer to make them wooden cubes. And I know you've spoken with the designer, right? Can I interact with him? Did you talk about this particular issue?
We did. Yeah, I did an interview by email, which I then published on the blog. And I think the notion, I can't summon it, so I'm not quoting from it, but I understand the notion to be, we wanted to not sort of stray under the realm of misrepresenting, right? We wanted to make sure that we didn't do what Puerto Rico did and just have a bunch of little brown cubes that are unspecified. I don't know what exactly I think about that. It's very interesting. One of the things that some players have done with freedom, I think I've seen this more on pages from European, they happen to be European gamers. I don't know how often it happens in the States, but people will make custom pieces for their games for freedom. And they'll have like little 3D printed chain links or actual enslaved people. And you know, that can start moving into realms that would make a lot of people uncomfortable. It makes me uncomfortable to see there's a kind of almost a safety in the abstract quality helps keep this critical sense of distance. Mm-hmm.
I think that's exactly it in terms of like A.G. Porfirio talked about this with when he did Hostage Negotiator. And in that game, he has you rescuing hostages, and the hostages are like these genderless, featureless, yellow meeples, right? And he's like, oh, you know, and people were asking him, like, okay, you should make them real people. And AJ's like, no way. Yeah. Some of these people die. So we do not want people to have that strong, an emotional negative experience, that the more that we can do to like bring us in the space, but like abstract it out so there's emotional distance, there's safety in there, the better. And I think freedom goes that extra step of like, these are just wooden cubes. And, you know, because there's this, the slave market phase four is the most difficult, most thematic of the game, because the slaves come in. And then if you can't fit them, they go onto the slaves lost track, which slaves lost is a euphemism. So, you know, so I think making that more real would have been very difficult for folks.
There is a potential downside, though, and this is what I usually find. And, you know, it's great for instructors. We never really give straight answers. We just pose these unanswerable questions.
We're so annoying.
Exactly. But one of the things that happens in our play sessions when I played it in with my classes is that those abstract cubes, you just start pushing them around as pawns. I mean, the weird thing about, I don't know if you're intending to talk about this, but the weird thing about slaves and freedom is that they're literal pawns, that you don't represent the enslaved. You represent the abolitionists and anti-slavery mm-hmm. activists who are trying to free the slaves. Right. And they're just pushing wood. And so we were wondering, like, sometimes you might have to sacrifice an enslaved person. You might have to sacrifice one of your cubes to save more. how long has that cube been on the board? Is that one you've been working real, real hard to move up from the deep south? How invested are you in that cube? It's a lot harder to feel that sense of investment when it is just a neutral cube that you can't distinguish from any others. So some of my students were wondering what it would have meant to kind of individualize those cubes in some fashion.
Oh, they'd be very, maybe far less sacrificed. They'd be far, I think you'd be worse at the game.
Yeah.
You almost have to have an abstract just to make it work as a game.
But, you know, it raises these really fascinating questions about the designer's choices. And then those become questions that every future designer has to consider in some fashion.
So that takes us to the second part, which is the aspirational quality, right? I mean, you can't have slaves in your game without their struggle to be free. My whole video in Puerto Rico was that it erased the people are clearly there, but it erased their struggle. Mm-hmm. And there is no understand. I will stand by this. And I think current historiography backs me up here. There is no understanding slavery without any captivity. It doesn't even have to be like colonization or anything. There's no understanding that without understanding their struggle to be free. There's always a rebellion in there somewhere. And there's always either large rebellions or micro rebellions, struggles, resistance, the whole thing. So then the slaves pieces themselves don't have that struggle. They are represented by the abolitionist side. You are playing an abolitionist. Insofar as there are slaves represented, there are people that are on the railroads, Harry Tubman and, you know, a couple other people. The designer actually says that he kind of regrets that choice as a designer. Like, I should have given the slaves themselves more agency.
Yeah.
Right. And I think you had that conversation. I think I saw that on your blog, right?
Yeah. This is a game that's players are not asked to be enslaved people who are trying to flee. They are asked to be the anti-slavery workers and Underground Railroad conductors and whatnot who are doing that work. Which, you know, so that you've got a layer in between. There's player, there's the enslaved, and then there's your avatar in the game who is not a slave. And that is an interesting design choice. And it certainly has a consequence for the message that the game puts out. The slaves here are literal pawns in the hands of others. And so that does cut against the historiography that you're talking about, which you're absolutely right, is axiomatic. Nobody can do any work on slavery or captivity without assuming that as a fundamental thing, that this is an unfortunate state that nobody wanted to be in.
And they pushed against it and against it and against it in all the ways.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. We do have, the game makes a really interesting point in that those anti-slavery activists were a really important part of that resistance. Without them, try to play freedom without any anti-slavery activists. You can't get anyone north. That's an overstatement of the historical reality, but it does kind of suggest that there is a role for these people that is perhaps neglected. I've never seen abolitionists in any other board game.
Yeah, I mean, in a way, this game is about abolitionists.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I hear people that talk about, well, this is a slavery game. It's not a slavery game. It's a liberation game. It's in the name, freedom. It's not called Slavery the Underground Railroad. It's called freedom. And I said that at Dice Tower, and I stick with it because I didn't realize until the name was staring me in the face the entire time, but you know how like things disappear into the background until you kind of see him again. And it's like, oh my God, this game is called freedom. And then it kind of opened up, like, you know, this whole idea of like, oh, this game is about aspiration and liberation, all that kind of thing. So I don't know as much about the abolitionist side. Does the game teach you the abolitionist, and the does it represent that side well? Are you able to kind of learn good lessons, good history from that side of it?
You certainly encounter the possibilities of it. There are a lot of the event cards. So the abolitionist avatars, I think there are six of them, if I remember correctly. Two are African-American. So that's a ratio that definitely could have changed. Mm-hmm. It was certainly the case that African-Americans were critical players in the abolitionist movement. In fact, I don't think there would have been an abolitionist movement that the radical movement that pops out in 1831 with William Lloyd Garrison. That would not have happened if there hadn't been African-Americans speaking with him and other white abolitionists or people who are ready to become radicals. African Americans radicalized those immediate abolitionists, and they played important roles, even though oftentimes even the white abolitionists were trying to marginalize them. So, you know, it was not an easy story. And some of that conflict is presented in the game and that the avatars have different abilities, right? So at least all the activists aren't exactly the same. They have different specialties and stuff, but you don't get into intense conflict between them, which is probably fine for this.
Yeah, right. Yeah. I mean, I guess like, because you don't want games to be perfect historical sims. You can't, right? There's so much stuff, and goes back to the very valid point about, you know, games have to, you know, simplify and reduce and everything. I think that if you try to make a sim, you're not going to make a fun game. And I think I liked your video where you detail like some of the things that that Freedom has to like kind of not get quite right. Like, you know, as an example, reaching Canada was the liberation point. And there were a lot of ways that slaves reached liberation. Like they went down to Florida, or they went to across the ocean, or they joined the army. And there was a lot of different ways that that could have happened. But for the game perspective, it had to just, okay, one way, Canada.
And in doing that, it kind of, there's a lot of historical mythology around the Underground Railroad. And so one of the things I do with students when we look at this game in class is we try to encounter some of that mythology. One of the myths, for example, is that it was all sort of white Quakers in Southern Ohio who were doing the work. And the reality is that it was African Americans, people like David Ruggles in New York or William Hayden in Boston. William Hayden was a free African American guy living in Boston who his home was known as a stop on the Underground Railroad. And so he became a target of slave catchers. So there's one famed incident where he faces them down as they're coming up onto his porch, and he says, "I've rigged my porch with explosives. So you step one, you know, make one step further, and we'll all find out whether I'm speaking truth or not." And they backed off. So there's a lot of kind of, you know, historical mythology about the role of white people in this thing, and going to Canada is part of that. So, you know, the game is more complicated than that. The cards lend it a kind of specificity. But there is a sense in which it kind of upholds that basic mythology.
You know, I think that Canada. Like there's history as facts, and then there's history as story. And like, I think that a game can get all sorts of facts fudged up, just like art. Game is art. Anything is art. You're going to fudge it up because you want to craft some kind of message, some kind of story. And I think a game does well, even if it messes a bunch of facts up, if this basic story kind of jibes with the lived experience of people who are there at a time, right? I think a game goes astray, thinking of some of the colonization games, where it's telling a completely different story. And it gins up like the most absurd facts to justify that story. So like, you know, the story that like, you know, the colonies, the slaves liked being colonized, or, you know, like they were liberated. It was a favor to them and all that kind of thing. And there's a definite strain of history, and it was really, really prevalent back in the day. And even now there's still, you'll still see strains of it where like the story is that colonization was a good thing, and like an unqualified good thing. It lifted people up. And I totally get how people like, well, there were some good things, some bad things, weren't there? Yes, I want to have that discussion. But I think that there are different media, games, movies, whatever, that tell that unqualified good story.
Yeah.
And I absolutely want to. And I think that's different than saying the facts are a little fudged up.
Sure. I see in games like in those games, a kind of, there's a weird thing about presenting colonial history in these games. And that I think originally that notion was deemed a kind of safe or comfortable space for designers and players, right? Almost nostalgic in a way.
Right. Like, oh. So it's escapist fantasy.
Exactly.
It's like going to a resort. It's like
or like Sid Meier's Civilization, that whole series is like just was built on this notion that, yeah, expansion is good. It's all about national boundaries and national cultures and all this kind of stuff. I mean, it sort of falls apart as real history. But that was kind of the safe space for a long, long time. Since gaming culture has broadened, since gaming audiences have broadened, since we've begun to connect some of the academic to the representation. I think that that's going to be changing. I know with Struggle of Empires, when Eagle Griffin recently re-released it, and Ralph Anderson, the guy who led that project, was very concerned about the representation of slavery in that game. So he sort of renames it as it becomes the Gold Coast Trade. Well, that's a choice that people can argue about, but there, at least there is a consciousness and awareness there that in the time from the first to the next edition of Struggle of Empires, there had been a massive change in public right. attitudes toward these things and in gamers' attitudes.
And to me, I'm tired of talking about colonization games. Let's talk about other things. There's so much history, people. So look what Assassin's Creed did. Speaking of that, it's like everything is there. Anyway, we don't have to get bogged down there. Okay, so we've talked about the slaves themselves. Is there anything else that you want to say about the abolitionist side before we get on to?
Yeah, but the one thing I think that's interesting in this game, this kind of a point of interpretation that baffled me, was that there's no way to actually end slavery in the game. You can get slaves out of slavery, but there's no mechanism for actually destroying the institution, which is a little bit odd. The game actually goes into the Civil War. There's the third phase of the game is set in the Civil War. And yet the key outcome of the Civil War, which is the destruction of slavery, doesn't really have a place in the game. So look, it's easy to take pot shots, and that's not what I'm here to do. Mm-hmm. The point is that like, because considering what came before, which was virtually zero,
yeah,
that was incredible, right? So I don't mean to undermine it in any way. It's just, again, setting some of the markers for what, you know, people might want to think about as you go into the future.
Exactly. This is, I hope that folks take this as not as criticism, because I think that is a very easy thing for folks to do. Like, oh, we're just criticizing, tearing down. This is out of complete and utter love. This is out of anybody who wants to be in this space. And we absolutely welcome that as, you know, doctor of history and a complete amateur, but who loves history. I want to be in this space more. And I would love to like kind of just lay some track how people can kind of further explore. If you want to, you know, if you're going to enter back into this space, that's something to think about. Absolutely. You know, as a victory condition, it's like, boom, we're good. You know, okay. So then the last part, and this is, so some of this is a little bit of a rehash when we talked about in the previous podcast, some of it not. And I think we very much deepened the discussion. We didn't talk about these people at all last time. And this is, I think, the part that we're more aware of now in the aftermath of Colin Kaepernick, in the aftermath of George Floyd, in the aftermath of all this other stuff that now we're more aware of than ever. And I'm going to put a flag for this for people who are listening to this. This is, there's a dirty word, right? We're going to get political. And it's like, oh my God, keep politics out of my board games. If this is something that you don't want to talk about, if you don't want to apply board games to present day stuff, then you're probably good on, you know, the podcast for now. I hope that you've learned something, but we are going to enter that space. We're going to enter the space of just relevant stuff that's happening right now. And it's unfortunate because we thought we did, in a way, like we didn't talk about the third thing, which is the slave patrols, the instrument of repression, right? Which is my third point. And when we talked about it in 2017, it wasn't in our consciousness that, like, you know, it was just a different time. You know, Hamilton was there, immigrants are good, and Obama's our president, and, you know, there's all sorts of like multiracial democracy is winning. And then, or 2017, Trump was president, but like we just came off of Obama, we didn't know. Right? We didn't know what we were in for, but now
it's no more.
Yeah. We know what, I got a quote here from a historian, Eric Fomer, who said that the history of America, it can kind of breaks down to two different strains, a yearning for multiracial democracy and a yearning for white supremacy. And they've never quite, neither of them have won. They're always in tension. You know, even when one is in charge, the other is bubbling up and trying to make room. So the slave catchers in a real way represent white supremacy.
Yeah, absolutely. Right? I mean, that's whether they represent some, they could represent the slave patrol, right? Which was a whole bunch of people throughout the white South who were often charged by law with policing the countryside to make sure that enslaved people were commuting and getting together and plotting and planning and whatnot.
And let's talk about, like, just the breakdown of slave patrols. Like, the interesting history there is that it's not like the, like there's no police back then. There's no professionalized police. There's no departments. If you look at every city in the country, their police departments are founded like the late 1800s, early 1900s. So at the time, the policing was really at the level of the town and even at the level of just individual people, kind of with a sense of what order, what society should look like, taking it upon themselves, deputizing themselves, and having the kind of the blessing of the state in order to carry out that violence. So yeah, it was law enforcement was a much more diffused community project than it would be now, than what we would be used to.
And yeah, and to call it law enforcement in the South, I think is almost a misnomer. It was about slave enforcement, right?
Order enforcement.
Yeah, it was about maintaining the hierarchy in that society. So, there was we're talking about a stage of American history where the state, like state institutions, are very weak and they're very small. Only like big cities like New York could even manage to try to put together like a constabulary or some kind of a prototypical police force before the Civil War. It happened, but it was rare. Throughout the South, you didn't have that. Instead, what you had was an entire society dedicated to the premise of white supremacy, right? So, you know, only about 20% of Southern families had any owned human property. Only about 5%, less than 5% of individuals in the South owned human property. How do you get everyone else in that society on board with protecting your form of property?
You hire them.
And of seceding from the Union to do it in 1861. And one of the ways you get them to do it is white supremacy, right? That's how you get, you make them join the slave patrols. You make them want to join the slave patrols because the threat that is there is that if you do not control these people, if you do not help us maintain slavery, then you will lose whatever social status you have, whatever social position you have. You will be put into competition with these people. And so no matter how sort of socially low you were as a white person, you were always promised that you were higher than the highest black person, even a free African-American person in the antebellum South.
And so you were usually part of a militia, you were usually armed. You know, it didn't take much to get you drafted in. And it was, in a way, it was like, you know, Dr. Rael saying, like, it was a way to unite rich and poor.
Absolutely. It's how you have these class cleavages, rich and poor, but you pull them together with race, right? You get people to think that that's the most important component of their identity, as it was. Like, we're not, you know, so working class, poor people, white people are not thinking about how the slaveholders are dominating government and not helping them economically. You get them thinking about the threat is really coming from below, and that's what we need to worry about. And of course, that's something that persists after slavery, as you've suggested. In Reconstruction and the Jim Crow South, racial order was maintained partly through contract, right, through labor contracts. But there wasn't a large, powerful state that could control the labor of African Americans. That was really done more at this level of sort of local social attitudes and behaviors.
And people that were deputized by culture, by rich interest, by whatever state mechanism was there. I think that's what, when you look at the pieces, like I really want to kind of stay with the game, right? When you look at those five pieces with the five shapes, and again, this was an intentional designer choice. Like, they didn't want meeples with guns. They didn't want, like, you know, like if you turn the shit around, there's a guy on a horse. So like they could have put, you know, meeples on horses and whatever. But I think that the designer made a choice to say, okay, I want to abstract this because I don't want to kind of enter that space, but it's right there.
Right.
It's right under the surface. And if you just want to keep it as a game, it's a game. But if you want to just peek a little bit into the history, you would just open up this whole, again, it's like this, America is always two impulses. It is the impulse to multiracial democracy, and it is the impulse to white supremacy. And I think we've gotten a little bit sloppy with our discourse, where it's like anyone who speaks, who criticizes the multiracial part will say, you're a white supremacist. And when we're talking about white supremacy, we're talking about something very, very specific.
Exactly.
And we saw it. We saw it. And again, if you don't want to hear politics in your board games, you're good to shut this off. That was what we saw on January 6, 2021.
Yeah. I mean, that's what that event was about. And that's, unfortunately, that's what a good chunk of that political party is about. It's built on, it's the message is white supremacy.
Whether it's explicit or implicit, it is a sense in which there are people in the country. And again, I'm not saying this is every single conservative. I'm not saying this is every single Trump voter or anything like that. Believe me, I'm a doctor. I have to work with everybody. And I'm just focusing on the people that are like at the tip, the radical tip. And there are people who look at the White House, who look at power, who look at, I think it was in Wilmington in like the late 1800s, where there was an actual coup. Like, you know, they had elected a biracial a town like leadership, and there was a literal coup to replace them with people who adhere to white identity politics. The Tulsa riot in the 1920s was, Black Wall Street. Blacks are inventing things. They're building wealth. They're getting patents. They're doing all these things, and then a white backlash. You know, I really have to be really careful to distinguish people who, have their criticisms of multiracial democracy and everything from white supremacy. That's a different thing. And the white supremacists, they look at power and they say, that's mine.
Well, the interesting
thing, that's mine.
I mean, those are cycles, like the fancy academic word for that might be like a dialectic, right? You have the struggle for freedom, and then it generates this sort of backlash. Oh, we don't want to give up our privileged caste position, our property in our whiteness, our symbolic property. And so there's fight back, and it's like, okay, so we do this. This is most of our history consists exactly of that. Mm-hmm. And this is a game that reminds us of that. This is an early stage. It's not the earliest stage of that, but it's the critical one, because it's the one where the strongest symbol of white supremacy, slavery, died as a consequence of the Civil War. So and the interesting thing I find about the slave catchers is, again, it just marries so effectively with the message, right?
Right.
Because when you're in a co-op, you're playing a co-op, you have to play an opponent, right? In pandemic, you're playing viruses. In Shadows over Camelot, you're playing Mordred or whatever it is. So the system has to play you back in some way. That is your kind of constraint. And in this game, it's the perfect villain, right? It's the slave catchers. Who better to represent the limitations of freedom?
And the way that, so you mentioned, I'm so glad you mentioned the pandemic meeples, right? That pandemic disease cubes. The disease cubes are random. They just appear. Right. And they're there, and, and you have to go to them and deal with them. And the game overwhelms you by multiplying. Mm. Right. But it doesn't care about you. It's just doing disease things. In freedom, there's only ever five slave catchers, and they follow you.
Yeah.
And that little difference of the way the AI is, different and creating that resistance. Like, you can't move unless you're in the very South. You can't move without triggering a slave catcher movement. And in a very subtle mechanism is the message way, that is how a slave felt whenever, and maybe they might have even been deputized by their master to go represent them in a trade or something, to go pick this thing up or whatever. So like, they have a writ that says, I'm on behalf of my master, I'm going to pick up this thing. And didn't matter. The whole point of the slave patrol was to follow.
Right.
And keep the person in their place. And sometimes even just, do all sorts of violence to them. And like, just the fact that the slave pieces are so ever present, you can never forget they're there.
Yeah, I love this. And, I hadn't put thoughts to this extent, but I love this point. It is like the precariousness of movement, right? The danger of moving. And so like moving itself is a kind of freedom, right? And there are trans-historical ways of thinking about this. Like there recently, you know, like you think about the Green Book, which was in the early 20th century, it was the book for colored travelers to, in quotations. And it told you all the places you could go without having to worry, you know, this is a sundown town. These people are terrible. Stay at this hotel in this place. And so free movement itself becomes a kind of expression of liberty and freedom in some way. So here the constraint on that is pretty effective.
Mm-hmm. And it's so easy because, you know, I'm very careful to avoid the term racism. You know, like, and I think that that's what happens with these conversations, but, oh, you're saying this thing is racist, that's racist, everything. And I'm very careful to avoid that term because it has a very personal connotation. Like, you know, if you're a racist, you must hate people. Yeah. Right. And yes, there's a lot of hatred involved. And I think that the, you know, the bleeding edge of the slave catcher, slave patrol movement, you had, you know, like pure abject personal hatred. I think it's a bit, the better way to think of it is like, okay, these are people who believe that society is a certain way. They believe that there's an order to society, and they look at that order and they think, okay, I must defend this. And if that order is threatened, then, you know, I will not stop until it's threatened. So like, you know, imagine, I heard this, you know, when the rioters came into the White House, it's like, they're looking at the White House like they look at their own house. And somebody else is sitting in their house on their couch, eating potato chips, watching your big screen TV. What would you do if you were like, if it was you and there was somebody in your house, would you say, oh, okay, you can have my house. I'm going to go over to the next house. No, you would defend your house. So that's a different thing than hatred because, you know, And it's actually, in a way, it's more powerful because in a way, they won't stop.
Well, it's
like become, it's not going to stop.
That sense of order that you draw on is so normative in their minds. You know, that's just the way it is. So like I grew up in Washington, D.C. and then did my work in the Bay Area of California. So pretty big, pretty diverse places. I'm in a smaller state now that has one of the smallest populations of color in the whole union. And I see that operative, like I hear that in people like in coffee shops and stuff, just a sense of they're taking it. And it's like, I didn't really understand that so many people just thought of it. And it doesn't come out of animus or hostility. It just comes out of a sense, what they think of it as rightness. And of course it's a fiction, right? It's a complete nonsense.
The mind sense, the worldview, yeah.
No more belongs to white people than to anyone else. It's just complete. But they don't, of course, don't understand it as racism. And it's, because its experience is normative, they take offense if you call them that.
So it you have to be really careful, right? These things, I don't want to accuse anybody of racism. I think like the watchers of this show, by and large, believe in the idea of a multiracial democracy. You know, anybody who watches this program is on some level, at least it believes in it or is open to it or whatever it is. And I don't want to accuse anybody who watches the show of anything else like that. I guess I'm just trying to understand and help people understand, because a lot of the reaction to that, what happened on January 6th, was shock. Mm-hmm. Like it blew people's minds. How could this happen? Blah, 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 blah. And to folks who have done the work to study the history, to folks who understand the, you know, the strain of white supremacy, like, and I've really tried to, it's not like I'm blessed with this. I've really done this, tried to do this work as much as I can. I wasn't surprised at all.
Yeah,
I'm guessing you weren't that surprised either. Like you were probably surprised, but not shocked.
I was appalled, but not surprised. And particularly after seeing what's been going down over the last 4 years. But so it is kind of extraordinary. And I think that it's important for Americans to understand that we are living we are so used to thinking that or so many Americans are so used to kind of just latently thinking that the arc of history always goes upward in some fashion.
We passed civil rights in 1965. We're good. We're good, people.
And of course, that's not the case. And so it is an important corrective to that. And I think people have to have the intellectual and moral courage to kind of acknowledge that, that, you know, in a lot of ways, we are at a real trough and and relative to our past, we are. So it's not like in, by some absolute term, but relative to where we've been, we are down. Like we have not been at a place like this really since maybe the impeachment of Andrew Johnson and the Civil War. Mm-hmm. So
in terms of like lack of national unity, you know, a lack of under like a just complete divergence of what America is and just kind of not being on the same page.
Fundamental questions about who's going to be part of democracy, right? When you voter suppress in a world that is as media aware as ours is, and you get away with it, that is astounding. Like we have, we have gone really far backwards on a lot of these points, and it's very difficult. I think particularly I get this among my students who want to be hopeful about their past, who want to be invested in their country. But if you're going to have open eyes about where we are now in relation to our history, it's very hard to feel good about this place. Right. You know, we have to focus on what we can change, the kind of good trouble that you referenced before with John Lewis.
It takes all types. What I want to specify with this review, with this discussion, is that A, there is a far tip that really does believe in white supremacy and that it has existed throughout our history. It you know, it was there in 1776, is there now, and it's right there in our board game.
Yeah.
Like, absolutely. And it was hiding right in plain sight. We didn't talk about it in 2017, but it's right there, which is an unbelievable thing to meditate on.
It's and in thinking about freedom, once again, I haven't seen anything that does that work since then, you know, which is not to say that it does its work perfectly. One thing that the game, the slave catchers are the critical component that you're playing against. You're also playing against some cards and, you know, some money problems and stuff like that. But on the board, it is the slave catchers. What you don't really get is the practice of slavery on plantations themselves, right? That's not sort of represented in the game that they didn't, you know, particularly try. Right. But I do think it's important for folks to realize that the slave catchers, that's obviously bad. But the reality is that slavery was enforced in a very local, in very, very intimate ways. And it was done by people who came from all, they weren't all Tom Loker style slave catchers. That's a character from Uncle Tom's Cabin. Like in the history of the anti-slavery movement, slave catchers are usually considered particularly villainous, you know,
right. And mustache twirling and hanging out in the corner. And it's like, well, I'm going to follow them. Yep.
They're low people with low morals, all this kind of stuff. And that kind of did a work, even in the antebellum era, that was the case. And it sort of did a kind of work. It insulated the families who were practicing slavery, right? You didn't get to see inside the household where, you know, a child could get beaten for breaking a plate where, I mean, I won't go into the horrible catalog of things, but there is a kind of intimacy to the oppression of slavery that's not really represented in this game. It's not saying that it should have, by the way. I'm just, if we're going to think critically and comprehensively about what is represented and what's not, I do think that's an important thing in the future that people might want to consider.
There's so much. And I think, you know, kind of coming to a summary point with this conversation, we've hit all the points and the controversies. I think the summary point is that A, we do believe that games can be good conveyances for this stuff. You know, I think both Dr. Rael and I believe that games are cultural products like art, movies, music, and if done well, they'll never truly encompass what the subject matter is, but at least they will help you bring you to that antechamber so that you can continue that journey of yourself. There's so much that freedom doesn't have, but that it points us to. Freedom isn't like a circle. Freedom's like an angle. And it's like, you know, it starts you and then but it points you in the right direction to learn all the stuff that's not on the board game, but at least it's pointing you in a direction that I feel, and I think you agree, that is very, very fruitful. for learning and for understanding our history.
I have found it to be that way, and my students have too. So I endorse this game wholeheartedly, and I'm really excited to see how this art advances forward as we continue to try to incorporate these important historical issues in board games.
And, you know, and I think talk about the aspirational goal. The aspirational goal is a multiracial democracy. You know, the aspirational goal is not to displace anybody or anything. You know, like, I mean, I'm talking to a white man right here. You know, I'm not saying that, you know, that we need to replace or anything. Like, I really believe in this stuff. And I think that, you know, I want to appeal to people on all the whole spectrum who believe in that. And like, I want to honor people's criticism. If you're on the right, you criticize the left. You have the right, you criticize the right. I'm good on that stuff. I'm good to have those conversations. It's just, there is another side that we probably should do a little bit more work to understand more so that we know what we're dealing with.
Yeah. And I think when we're thinking about games, and it's so, we sort of want to know the right answer, right? So it does this game depict it correctly or not? And in some ways that's unanswerable, because right, everyone is going to have their own particular take on that, depending on their values and what they bring to the experience. For me, the valuable thing is, I mean, I think there are some, we need to set acceptable boundaries of what is in here and what's not. But the conversation itself is the rich part. It is the talking of what is at stake, what is in play, what have we missed? Those are the useful conversations mm-hmm. that move this whole art forward in a productive and constructive way.
Dr. Patrick Rael, that was some conversation. You are not going to get this board gaming content anywhere else. I can guarantee you that.
Well, thanks for, you know, creating the platform for it. I think it's really important work, and I appreciate you for doing it. And I'm sure a lot of your viewers do as well.
Where can we catch up with you? Are you keeping up with your blog? Are you doing anything else that's public in the board gaming space?
I am. I've got my blog going. I hope to be adding to it. These COVID months have been hard to get in some game writing, but I've been playing some interesting games relating to the Civil War and slavery. There's a fascinating one called, what is this called? This Guilty Land by Tom mm-hmm. Russell,
yes,
which is about slavery. And I've just broken that out, and that's a fascinating thing. So I hope to be writing about that and some other games to talk about the politics of slavery before too long.
All right. That is Dr. Patrick Rael. This is Jason reminding you, if you can change your mind, you can change the world. So until next time, later, everybody.